Hello, my name is Amanda Gonzaga, and today I will be walking you through a MycoCosm KEGG browser tutorial. Before I get started, I just wanted to introduce myself. I am a UC Berkeley student majoring in environmental science with a minor in CalTeach or science and mathematics education. I am currently interning at the Joint Genome Institute where I am working with MycoCosm, JGI's fungal genome portal. A little fun fact about me is that I love hiking, hence the picture of me at Yosemite. Let me turn on this printer. Okay, so here's a bit of an agenda for today's walkthrough. I will begin by discussing what JGI is and their mission, and this is followed by a discussion of MycoCosm and what it is. I'll follow this with an introduction into yeast, which leads us into understanding what KEGG is and its utility for examining metabolic pathways, as well as kind of just going over what is a metabolic pathway. And this leads to our case study, which I will walk through on MycoCosm, and a conclusion to wrap up this tutorial all nicely. So the Joint Genome Institute, abbreviated as JGI, is part of the Department of Energy and is located at the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory. JGI offers numerous tools such as high throughput sequencing, DNA design and synthesis, computational analysis, as well as, you know, if you sequence some DNA, you might want to look at it. And so JGI does it all. JGI supports the worldwide community of researchers seeking to advance the frontiers of bioenergy to transition from fossil fuels to renewable sources of fuel. MycoCosm is a resource that can help us to better understand the powers of fungi and harnessing it to accomplish these missions. I will be telling you a little bit about MycoCosm, and it's a fungal genome portal, as I said, but it has over 2,000 genomes in it. The homepage shown here displays the family tree of fungi. However, it should be noted that the tree expands to include specific species, and trying to show the entire tree would be impossible to read. Fungus is a diverse kingdom. Even between phyla, each is vastly different. First off, Basidiomycota. This phyla includes mushrooms and rust, so what you typically think of when you think of fungi. But then there's also Ascomycota, and it has main two subphyla, Pizizomycotina, as well as Saccharomycotina. And fungi in these subphyla include anything from truffles to yeast. There is also diversities in species within a genus, both Trichophyton claviceps, and Dicara are all part of Ascomycota. Trichophyton is a genus that causes athlete's foot or even ringworm. Meanwhile, claviceps is a fungus that grows on rye and when consumed can lead to hallucinations. Then we have Dicara, which is a yeast that is sometimes used to make beer and wine. What other uses are there for yeast? First and foremost, you may be thinking of baking and cooking, you know, baker's yeast. You may also be thinking of brewer's yeast and using yeast to make alcohol such as beer. However, yeast has technological uses as well. It can be used for genetic research. It can also be used for drug testing in the pharmaceutical industry. Yeast may also be used to create biofuels. How, may you ask? Well, I'll tell you. How do we get from a bunch of yeast cells to biofuels, and why does this matter? Well, first off, yeast can produce ethanol, a biofuel alternative. Rather than pumping your car full of fossil fuels, you can pump it full of biofuel. And this research can lead to the future of cars running on renewable energy. But how do we get from yeast to ethanol? Well, like humans, yeast need to eat, and their favorite food of all is sugar. And our cycle begins with yeast eating some sugar. This process is called fermentation and results in the production of ethanol and carbon dioxide. And what do we do with ethanol? We make our cars go vroom vroom. Now comes the question, do all yeast like the same things? We can test this in a lab by growing yeast on petri dishes. We end up seeing that one yeast species is able to grow on the sugar given to them, but the other is not. And the specific sugar is called galactose. And what's galactose? Galactose is very similar to glucose, a sugar that we have heard of most commonly in when learning about photosynthesis. The only difference between these two is the location of the OH group. But that's some organic chemistry we don't really need to get into right now. So it turns out that these two yeast species are named Dicara and Pichia. They are part of the same family, so why can't they both grow on galactose? Well, you can't really grow on something if you can't digest it. If you can't eat it, you can't gain anything from it, so you can't really grow on it. And this answer turns out to be related to galactose metabolism, which is essentially the eating of a sugar. If you can't eat galactose, you can't grow on it. This is where KEGG browser comes in. Galactose metabolism is an example of a metabolic pathway. Another example of a metabolic pathway is the citric acid cycle. And this is commonly taught in classrooms because it describes the chemical reactions required to release stored energy in cells. This is, you know, the backbone of why the mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell. Metabolic pathways, put in simple terms, describes the enzymes used to gain energy from eating. This is where KEGG comes in, the Kyoto Encyclopedia of Genes and Genomes. The KEGG browser allows you to see which enzymes are involved in specific metabolic pathways. And from here, we can investigate this using MycoCosm. So once you click on the link that I had on the last slide, you will be taken to the homepage for this specific case study. And you will see this list of species that we're only really focusing on too, so don't get overwhelmed. From here, we will click on tree, which gives us a visual representation of the evolutionary relationships between the yeast. The tree enables us to conduct comparisons and understand the relationships between these species, and that kind of goes for every part of the tree, not just for yeast. So the two species we were looking at were Dicara and Pichia. So here we see Pichia, and we want to check or verify that Dicara, which grows on galactose, and Pichia, which doesn't, are sibling taxa. So if we go up the tree, we see Dicara right here, and we end up finding out this green box highlights like all the ones encompassed. We see that Dicara and Pichia are in fact sibling taxa. Next, we will be clicking on Dicara brucellensis. This will take us to the homepage for Dicara. This gives some background information, a brief summary of the species for users unfamiliar with it. And you can click on just about any species on MycoCosm and get a similar homepage with different information depending on the species. And from here, we will click on annotations and go to KEGG. And this will take us to the KEGG browser, which displays the metabolic pathways and associated genes for Dicara. And genome annotations, because there are quite a few others you could click on. In short, describe the function of a gene or a stretch of DNA sequence. In our specific circumstance, we are looking for the metabolism of certain sugars. So we're going to scroll down to carbohydrate metabolism, and carbohydrate is just another word for sugars. And we will go to galactose metabolism. And here we see that you see this number 24. What does 24 mean? It's not Kobe's number, sadly. But this 24 tells us that there are 24 genes associated with galactose metabolism in Dicara. So now we will click on galactose metabolism, which will take us to the similar looking page, except this time, instead of seeing different metabolic pathways, you instead see EC number. Well, what is an EC number? EC number means the enzyme commission number. It's a classification scheme for enzymes. So rather than reading out lengthy enzyme names every time you refer to it, you can just read out the reference number. saves time and energy, and some of these are very long words. So here we will select Dicara and Pichia. If you're having trouble, click, just shift and click, and then hit apply. And I will click apply. And from here, our table expands, and we end up seeing Dicara in this column and Pichia in this column. So we want to look at what's different, because we know Pichia cannot metabolize galactose, but we want to understand why on the enzyme level. So first off, we see that galactokinase is present in Dicara, but not present in Pichia, which is what the zero means. If it's zero, it means it is not there. So that's something of note to think about. And then we go to UDP glucose, blah, 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 blah. And we see the same thing where it is present in Dicara, but not in Pichia. So we have two enzymes that we're looking at. And so their EC numbers are, they end in 6 and end in 12. I will not be reading out the whole number. So from this point, we want to view their KEGG maps. So you would click Dicara, apply. And once the page loads, you will hit view KEGG map. And it'll take you to something that looks like this. First look, very intimidating. There's a lot going on, but you don't need to pay attention to most of it, which is really great. What you need to pay attention to is the red boxes. Red boxes show if the enzyme is present in the species in this pathway. And if it's a black box or black text, it's not present. You don't need to worry about it. So here we see 6 and 12, which were our two enzymes that we noticed, are red boxes. So that tells us that they are present in Dicara in the galactose metabolism pathway. But what about Pichia? We can click on Pichia and view the KEGG map for it as well. That is not the KEGG map. Apologies, but here we go. We see the KEGG map and we see that these boxes, which were red with Dicara, are black with Pichia, which tells us these two enzymes are not present in this galactose metabolism pathway. And this hints that at a theory that, you know, these two enzymes are responsible for galactose metabolism, and without them, you cannot grow Pichia on galactose. But this can also be tested. So now that we know this information, why does it matter? So in conclusion, we know what causes the difference. It's these two enzymes, but why does it matter? Well, first off, there's industry. Yeast can be used for research ranging from biomedical to biofuel industries. So if you're trying to mass produce yeast, you should know what it likes to eat to make growing it more effective. And you know, so you can keep it alive, because if you feed it something it can't eat, like galactose, then it's just going to die. Second, the exploration of genes and thereby genetic engineering. If we know Pichia is missing two genes, we could transfer those genes from Dicara into Pichia, and we would be able to see if Pichia would now be able to grow on galactose. So our theory is that, you know, these two enzymes are responsible for it. So if it is if those enzymes are present in Pichia, can it grow on galactose? And this could either prove or disprove our findings. Lastly, we have process optimization. And this is an industry term for efficiency. Whether you're making beer, producing biofuel, you want to know how to best improve your process for time and cost. And energy efficiency. I just want to say thank you for sticking with me through the MycoCosm KEGG browser tutorial. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to reach out to me at my email address. Also feel to reach out to the MycoCosm team with any inquiries. Thank you.